So we're podcasting from our studio in beautiful Vancouver, BC, Canada. Welcome to another episode of the podcast that confirms safety does indeed have a personality.
This is the show where we get to know safety professionals on a lighter, more personal, and fun level. This is Safety Debris with me, Tanya Steele.
And me, Richard DeLong. Today, Tanya and I welcome our special guest, Leslee Montgomery. Leslee Montgomery is an energized speaker that works with individuals and organizations to understand the day-to-day drama impacting decision-making and their driving forces.
A professional counselor, a mental focus specialist with over 15 years of health and safety, Leslee has worked her way up from the field to corporate office supporting C-suite throughout several sectors of the construction industry.
She's passionate about helping her clients learn the leadership strategies they need to run a drama-free workplace. One of her favorite songs is by Marshall Mathers III, also known as Eminem. This is Soldier on Safety Debris. Yeah, that's the music of Eminem here on Safety Debris. Welcome back to another episode.
Hi, Leslee.
Oh my God, that is so great. I'm so, so excited to be here. And wow, ever now I'm exposed that everyone knows that I'm an Eminem fan, and that's one of my favorite songs. I love it.
It's a good song with the lyrics. I have a couple Eminem songs on my playlist as well. But yeah, it's good. Yeah. Why that song for you?
I find, you know, like there are some days when you get in the car and you're driving to the site and you know you don't want to. And it's one of those ones that kind of puts me in the right mind frame of, holy crap, this is what I'm walking into today. And there's a reason why I'm there. And there's a lot of other people out there. And I think for a long time in my career, especially in health and safety, I've correlated it. You know, you've got the field and you've got the office. And when you go into the field, you're like in active duty. And I never, ever want to be disrespected to anybody who served in the military. But there's a lot of soldiers out there that they show up. And they do come broken. And there's so many profound lyrics in there that describe what people put up with to just keep moving it forward, keep moving it forward. So it's one of those ones that it'll be like, yep, but I'm still going. So
yeah,
awesome. He's got a lot of songs like that that'll really help you release some rage, if you will. So instead of holding that steering wheel, like you said, when you get in that car and screaming, you can just sing along to his music. So
just get yourself into the right mindset. Here we go. Left, right, left. That's how we get through the day, right?
Yeah. I think that we all have those songs, right? That we listen to in the car when we need to be encouraged, or we need to, like, I need to be strong today because I'm not feeling strong, or I need to listen to something happy and just be joyful and fun. Like, I think that really songs really help our emotional state and our mental state.
Yeah. Oh, you know, 100%. Yeah. Sorry.
I was going to say, you know, we all deal with things on a daily basis, some not bigger than others. And, you know, we have peaks and valleys, and I have a Peloton, which is part of my release. So I ride almost every day, and I was riding on Saturday and went for a really long ride. And the nice thing about the Peloton is they align really well with music. So there's musical artists that you can choose to hear, or genres of music, all that sort of thing. And I chose a ride that had music from Chris Cornell from Soundgarden, Audioslave, and Temple of the Dog. And it was just strictly his music and some of his music that he recorded on his own. And there were a couple of songs in there that really hit hard, like emotionally, you know, they really spoke to me. And music's always done that to me. And I suppose that's why I have such a passion about it. I love music. I've worked in music and worked in radio. And so when I was listening to this particular song, I actually brought it to play on the playlist if we had time later. But I just thought, wow, you know, this really spoke to me and put me in a certain mindset. And it just got me ready for the day and for what I'm dealing with. And it just something I can lean on, you know? And I think that's what you're talking about when you're trying to get ready for that big day ahead of yourself, and you can put that song on that really moves you.
100%. Yeah, 100%. It's one that will, you know, when there's tons of times I can see myself driving over the Second Narrows Bridge and I'm so close. It's like, nope, we're just going to play the song right now because we know, and we know it sets everything in place. It's got like little cues in it, and there's places where I can yell, and it helps me
and
when
swear.
I go to job.
Oh yeah. I swear.
I definitely don't have a problem with the potty mouth. That's for sure. I call that Leslee's construction mouth, and we try real hard to make sure she stays at the door. It's so great when you race kids from this industry and you're driving in the car and you realize,
I didn't see you there, honey.
Yeah.
Right? And one looks to the other. Yeah. Mommy's in her zone.
Yeah. So no, it's fun. Pretty good. So
Leslee, yeah. I mean, even talking about, you know, this music and mental, like you're a professional counselor, you're a mental focus specialist. And so, you know, before we kind of, I mean, we've been talking about music here and how that mentally helps us, but maybe our listeners are really in a space of what does actually mental health mean? Like if you were to define it, I heard you speak at several conferences, but the most recent conference, and you define mental health. And I was just like, I'd never heard it that way before. So I'm pretty sure our listeners would love to hear that definition. It was very good.
Well, thanks, Anya. Yeah, I think when we start to talk about mental health, it goes into this really weird place of stigma. And I think a lot of people hear mental health and they associate that with mental disorder. And really, your mental health is just the health of your mind and your thoughts. And I think we forget that there's so much that influences because we're able to take for granted. And it's, I think, the one thing we can compartmentalize away from people so that really only us on this side of the fence know and understand what we're going through. But I think it's a tough dig to really get into the concept of where exactly is the health of my mental health today? And how do little things like getting enough sleep, or, you know, we were talking about my smoothie before we got going, like how does all of that stuff play into it, as well as the compounding day-to-day drama that keeps showing up in the workplace? Like,
yeah. It's good.
Big, heavy questions, right?
They are. And I love that when you were presenting, you really said there's mental disorder and mental health. And that's two different things. And when we say mental health, people automatically think of this, you have some mental issues. It's not. I love that, you know, we do need to, especially today, when so many people are struggling with mental health.
Yeah. Absolutely. You know, there's just so many, I think, instances on a daily, weekly, monthly basis that because it's kind of within our parameters of baseline, we really don't understand the ripple effect that it's actually having on us long term, until all of a sudden, you know, if we ignore a cold long enough, we get sick. Mm-hmm. If we ignore our mental health long enough, we do develop anxieties for reasons that we don't understand, but we've been so conditioning our brain to these kind of stimuli that all of a sudden it comes second nature. And then all of a sudden we're anxious about everything. We can't leave the house. Yes. And if we'd had the opportunity to just take a step back on days where we were feeling a little off, we would be able to kind of dig into it a little bit better and be like, oh, this is just a mental health thing. I'm just a little off right now. And I just need to figure out what need do I need to fill to satisfy it, right? Or to make it go away or make it easy. And maybe that terminology is off for a lot of people because it's not easy. It is a complete struggle when you start to get into it, because there's so much of it that people can't help you with, but they can bring you as close and as far as they possibly can. So, and then there's a lot of this journey. Sorry, go ahead, Richard.
No, yeah, don't apologize. I just want to catch you before we move away from it, because you talked about conditioning, and you're in the construction industry. That's what you cater to for the most part. And my question is, because of conditioning, or, you know, the way people have been brought up or introduced to things, how do you deal with that stigma of that mental health issue? How do you get around that in the construction industry?
Well, I'm pretty forward at this point. I think we all kind of get to that point in our career, and this is the sort that I'm willing to push. So I think I shock people with my approach to vulnerability. I know, prepping for my talk for BuildX 3 weeks out, my anxiety was through the roof. And I knew it was filtering out. And I was on the job site and we had done a scope of work and I was super unhappy about how it was unfolding. It was the end of the day. Most of us were checked out, but this wasn't the time to talk to the crew about it. But the next morning when I came in, I sat them down and said, listen, I'm super anxious right now. This is what I've got going on. And you guys are going to get the brunt of this energy. So we need to come to terms with it so you guys understand that it's not directed at you, but you can respond to it. And then this is where I think we need to up our game. And they all just kind of sat back and looked at me and were like, you know what? You're absolutely right.
Nice.
The scope of work yesterday, there was things that we, you know, it was 5 o'clock in the evening and three of us were there, but we were already checked out. Yeah. I had a vet appointment I knew I wasn't getting to. The young gentleman beside me had a physio appointment and all of this energy and we're all around each other and we're fighting against each other because we're trying to get it done. And I think it's those modalities that you, myself, we go out there and talk about going, this is when we're supposed to take five, right here and now.
Yeah, that's really good, Leslee. I love that the two things that you've said. Number one is you made yourself vulnerable. So you just like, hey, listen, I'm feeling anxious. I'm this. And number two, well, actually maybe number one is that you are brave enough to say, all right, I need to make this comment and I need to sit people down and I'm just going to say it. And in that bravery and then in that vulnerability, this amazing moment happened where you really began to touch lives. So Leslee, my question then is, how do you know that this style or what you're doing is actually making an impact with your crew or the staff?
So it's, so there's one crew I've been working with for about 4 years now, and the foreman and I have commented a couple of times, we wish we would have paid attention to the metrics when I started in 2019. What I can say is in the 4 years I've been working with them, we don't have underground reporting anymore. Everything's
reported. What do you mean by underground reporting? Just so people listening know that what that means.
So underground reporting is when an incident happens and it doesn't actually make it to safety, but it makes it to a foreman or somebody in charge who knows about it. And then they can make it go away however they see fit. If they want to keep Buddy on the payroll and send him home, challenges with that is, as you and I know, the claims department eventually catches up and says, hey, 3 months ago, you had somebody go to WCB. Where's all of your paperwork? And you go, what?
Yeah.
So we don't have that anymore.
Nice.
But I think
so you need to say you actually still do have those things exist on your sites that you, that underground, not willing to report.
They don't.
It is, it's phenomenal. The back-to-back conversations that happen where people come up to you and say, you didn't hear this from me. Oh, wow. I wasn't in this area. I wish that I could say it wasn't as prevalent as it is, but different ends of the industry, it absolutely is. My biggest one was a couple of years ago, working in the high rise end of the industry, and this particular project had a saw blade fall from quite high up, and somebody came by and said, you didn't hear this from me, to a CSO. Oh, boy.
Wow. You know,
so it happens, right?
Yeah, you didn't.
But I think the biggest win really is, and this, I was asked this question a couple of years ago and I didn't understand how to answer it. Somebody I had been working with told me, he said, you know what, when you came to our crew, we gave you 3 months. Wow. We didn't think you would last longer than that. And this was 2.5 years later. And he says, and I'm sitting before you today, a better man.
Wow. Now that's amazing.
And then you're just like, mic drop. Okay.
Yeah. So that, I mean, that's some impact right there. And also, I think it's really important to note in there is it does take time. Like, you know, they gave you 3 months, but it wasn't until 2 years in when they actually were so confident in your ability. And that was because you keep showing up, you're there, you make yourself vulnerable, you're brave, you're consistent. You don't, you know, when things start to fall apart, you just grab it and you go for it. And those are the things that really start to impact, in this case, construction workers, who really, we still have these stigmas of, oh, I'm so tough. And I'm, you know, I don't share that information or make myself vulnerable. Uh-huh. And we love to see that that's changing. And we know that, you know, in construction, Richard, I can't remember, was it the 26% of construction, 26% of our suicides here in the province of British Columbia. I don't know if that's, I don't even, Leslee, if you would know that stick, something like that. Anyways, 26% ish of our suicides in British Columbia are construction workers.
I was actually just looking at the national average, and it's astounding when you take a look at the numbers, because across Canada, our stats say there's 1.4 million of us, which that's 2.8 million work boots, by the way, that get laced up, which I think is phenomenal. But awesome. That's 62 individuals a month that don't make it back home, like don't make it back to the job site, like don't make it out of. And I really think, you know, some of the language that I'm falling into that I really love is that moment in life when you want your friend to fail is the only moment that they succeed. And we're all left sitting there going, what the hell just happened? What do you mean so-and-so? And being on a job site after a loss is, I don't even know how to explain it, but there's a difference when you lose somebody to a workplace accident, because it's tangible and you want retribution right away. And you can kind of get it through the investigation. But when you lose somebody to a suicide or something like an overdose, you're just dumbfounded. What do you mean? What just happened? The impact, the legacy that this individual had. And then you have to make space for the fact that for everyone who cares, there's one that doesn't. And they fundamentally don't understand. And you can't judge them from the fact that that was the way they were brought up, that for them, this is the ultimate act of betrayal to oneself. And so you need to make space for everybody amongst all of these issues, right? So
Leslee, I got a question for you, and that's how you attract clients to your business, how you align with them, how you work with them, how they get a hold of you. We're going to ask you that question, or ask you to answer that question, in just a moment's time. But first, let's listen to another one of your favorite songs. Let's slip one in here now. This one's called, the artist is called Tuyamo. And this is relatively new to me. I've not heard of Tuyamo before, but this is a very interesting song. This one's called Click, and it's on Safety Debris.
Out of control, whoa, she get it wet like a boat, whoa. Shorty on go, go, I keep a pound of that smoke, yo. Everything's slow, mo, I'm kicking this shit like a dojo. I got the mojo, pose for the camera, flick, click.
Straight out of the mosh pit. Yeah, that indeed was Leslee leading the pack, having some fun down there. And that was a fun song. That's Tuyamo, Click on Safety Debris. Today, we're speaking with Leslee Montgomery, a mental health specialist. And she is going to be answering the question, how is it that clients get a hold of you? Like, do you work with one client at a time for long periods of time? Do you have multiple clients? And if you do have multiple clients, how is it that they get in contact with you so that they can, you know, have your services available to them?
Well, we're growing organically, and most of the people that come to us through places like this, or individuals, consultants who see a need and say, hey, you know, maybe you should have Leslee come out. We usually start with either an assessment or a talk about where companies are struggling. You know, we have some pretty big ones, and sometimes from a consulting and a mental health perspective, it can be a hard sell, because you're trying to sell a return on investment that we're going to be looking at seeing results, tangible results, 6 months into a year. But the cool things that we start to see right away are metrics that we're not tracking. So one of the job sites I was on recently, I come walking down the corner, and there's two electricians, and they are friggin' going at it, like 6 feet apart from each other. I'm pretty sure they're still spitting on each other's face. That's how much they're yelling. It's an odd situation to walk into, because I think we're exposed to it quite regularly in our industry, so we become super desensitized to it. Mm-hmm. We respect most of the time that we don't actually film it when we walk by, because we know that that could end poorly for a lot of us. But I end up just circling back to foreman and stuff, and I'm finding out that on average, we're probably weekly investing about $2,000 in man hours to side toolbox talks about bullying and harassment in the workplace. So these are conversations I get to have at different levels to be able to open up minds and say, are you tracking this? Like, do you know how often this is happening? I think you know, because you're seeing the super lagging indicator on the other end, which is the fact that you're chasing turnover. Mm-hmm. People who aren't settled, who are mentally unhappy, where the morale is bad, or where we haven't figured out how. It can be something as subtle as we just don't know how to communicate appropriately across our communication styles, that if we could just sit down and have those discussions, and those are tough, vulnerable discussions for some individuals to say, hey, I don't know, but I just don't like the way you're talking to me right now. Okay, let's work with that and figure out how we can clean this up. It sounds really scary in the moment, but at the time when you actually sit down and flesh it out, it's like, oh, that's all you needed? Cool, I can do that.
Easy. You make it sound, right? you make it sound so easy, because we struggle so much. I mean, I've sat down with incredible safety consultants and leaders and directors, and we just look at each other and go, where do we start? Like, I don't even know what to do. And I appreciate you so much, Leslee, because, you know, through you spoke at our What If One conference on porta potties. What does your porta potty say about, was it your mental health? What was the title of that again? Is that right?
Yeah. What does your porta potty tell me about your safety culture?
Safety culture. Yeah.
From what's written on the inside.
Yes, that's right. Yeah. And I couldn't believe how many people were taking notes from stuff like that. And just to learn how you really just simplify this process. And so, you know, even for Richard's question, like how people get a hold of you, like, you know, we will put some contact information for them, but you are a keynote speaker, so they can have you come and speak. You do consulting with them. You work with corporations, you know, you help build all of this stuff. So and they can just get you either, you have a website now, right? If I remember correctly.
Yep. So I do have a website, and my social media really is LinkedIn. It's where I've found an amazing, open and accepting community, and thinking about going into TikTok. I've seen Tanya Steele on TikTok.
Yeah, I'm on TikTok. So. Come on.
He's on TikTok. Hey, Leslee, I want to ask you, because you're in consulting, the three of us are, such an, you know, what's the word, intangible type of service. How do you even begin to sell that to a client?
Yeah, another great question. Honestly, I think I sell myself in just when people meet me and get to hear about the passion behind the fact that in BC, so I did take a look at the stats, our numbers have come up in the last couple of years. So instead of 220,000, we're at 225,000. So that's another person we can expect to potentially lose, right? So we're looking at 12 people. And I think it's profound conversations with business mentors who will look me in the face and say, people don't know what they don't know.
Yeah, it's good.
And I believe, because for me, you know, it's like Tony Robbins thing, you know, red, and then all you see is red. For me, when I go out into the field and I see these things, it's easy for me to approach people and say, like, I think you might be struggling here, and I might be able to help you deal with the fact that you're uncomfortable with the realities of your position. And I think that's where I'm starting to make headway right now, is with the training that I'm doing, and I'm very open as well, is a lot of the problems we have is behavioral. And I really think when we introduced behavior-based safety, we didn't understand how to tackle it appropriately. And now we have embedded behaviors that come to us from the home.
Yeah.
And we don't know how to talk to each other. So what I do is I work with superintendents, and I help them have conversations with guys who are not cool for the project, not cool for the team. Instead of saying, well, that guy's out of here, and you see him show up the next day going, well, is he out of here or isn't he? Because your mixed messaging is letting the rest of us know that the needs of the one outweigh the needs of the many and the few. Thank you, Spock.
So, you know, what you do, Leslee, is really unique. It's unique to me. I don't know anyone else that does what you do. And I think, you know, to help the audience understand exactly how you fit in on a work site, are you that conventional NCSO who's walking around doing their safety thing at the same time being the mental health expert? Or are you that mental health expert solely and, you know, interacting with the people on the site?
Well, right now, I think it's a dual position.
Okay.
Right. It's like you don't find anybody in this city who's hired strictly for first aid and then for safety. Right. Right. You can maybe you still even want them to have a traffic control.
That's right.
Ticket. So one of the things that developed is a peer program to be able to help clone Leslie's so that, because there's some of us out there that we're forced into safety. We don't want to do it. It gives us a little bit of extra, but there's peer support people out here with lived experience who do want to be able to help people through some time. When I do go into the field, this is how the field sees me. Like I walk around like your NCSO safety person. I'm checking FLHAs. I'm seeing where we could address because it's part of the package, right?
Mm-hmm, yeah, mm-hmm. That's good.
I'm here for safety. When people ask me, who do you do safety for? I'm like, well, this is the company that pays me, but I do safety for everybody because that's what we're supposed to do. We're our peers keepers.
And it's not just safety. It is technically health and safety. So listen, you know, we have these listeners who are listening right now and they're just like, okay, I need to have Leslee come on my site, but, and I need to talk to you. But today, if you could give one piece of advice to another NCSO or a site superintendent or a manager, and they're going on site today, and they want to sort of look for some signs and symptoms, like, how do I know when to approach something like Leslee? She's been doing this. She's a professional counselor. Like, I don't know when I'm supposed to. What kind of one tangible thing could you give them today that they could feel confident going on site to really help this process go forward?
I think everyone's looking for something really, really quick. And the reality is it does take time to be able to walk onto a job site and pick up on stuff. You need to start paying attention to yourself. And if there's energy or something, tips that will tell you that something is off for me. Like
come up right
huge.
After this song. How about that?
Let's awesome. Hang it up there. Let's
have a little yeah. cliffhanger here. Okay? We're going to get the tips here in just a quick second. So
people think.
Let's listen to one of Leslee's favorite songs. This is one that she chose from. One. Yeah, this is a good one. This one's from Blackway and Black Caviar. The song is called What's Up, Danger? On safety debris.
2,000 on thermometers, 2,000 surrounding us. Travel 2,000 kilometers to hang out with us. What's up, danger? What's up, danger? Hey, didn't know they doubted us. Makes it that more marvelous. Sign them up because I'm in this vibe and I get synonymous.
All right, that is a great song. It's a band called Blackway and Black Caviar. And what's up, danger? And welcome back to Safety Debris. Our guest today is Leslee Montgomery, the lady who told us, this is the sword I'm going to push forward. And she's got some tips that she's going to give us that she led us into the song with. So, Leslee, what are those tips you were alluding to?
Left us hanging. Left us hanging.
Okay.
Well, tips.
Okay. So graffiti is a huge one that I pay attention to on a job site. As soon as I go in, I'd like to take a look at where it is. I definitely expect to see it in a portable toilet. But I have noticed certain industries, it's getting better. I do like to take a read of what's being written. I think you can get a really good feel of what's going on. Who are the staff complaining about? It'll hit the walls in there. What kind of jokes are they telling each other? We push the boundaries in there with appropriateness. But I think the other thing to remember is tip number two, we have old school empathy. I really do believe it. I have a t-shirt of somebody who passed away when I first started in this industry, and he's got his hard head on backwards. And I think it says it's nothing personal. He's flipping the bird, but he meant a lot to a lot of us. So we have old school empathy and we are trying to figure out how to make it come into new school empathy. So there are a lot of belonging cues on our job sites that I think as we move towards inclusivity and diversity, we have to take just a quick step back and understand what are we hearing and what need is that filling right now? Because some of the jokes or some of the inappropriateness that comes across is filling a need. So we have to be slightly open-minded as we're helping our crews become a little bit more diverse And then lastly, I would say, understand yourself as a communicator and understand your water cooler talk and how it filters out in your job meetings. There are a lot of times that we want to be accepted by our crews, especially if we are in a position of foreman, supervisor, or higher. And just like going for drinks at the end of the week, there's some language that we need to start cleaning up, because there are places that it's not appropriate to for us in these positions of leadership to be venting. We need a safer place, a peer group where we could take these vents offline to be able to have the respect and morale of our crew. Those would be my three big ones for sure.
I think that's great insight, because I'm not a mental expert. So whenever I step into a porta potty and I see the writing on the walls, I just see immaturity screaming out at me. But there's right? a lot more than just immaturity screaming out, obviously. And a trained mind like yourself can detect that and work with whatever is scribbled on those walls.
And I think you're
gonna next time you go on to a commercial project high rise, you just watch when the hoist comes down, and then you watch to see how many people, and you can pay attention in some of the porta potties. Someone will start to complain, you try walking up this many stairs, you, right? And so you'll catch it. And then I think in some cases, it really does come down to like, who's that entity that they're really kind of silently protesting against? Because you can almost track it back to the individual's office. It's so bizarre. It's so weird.
That's interesting, because I've never looked at it that. I mean, I'm the same as Richard, right? I'm a Gen Xer, and you show up for work. You know, we look at this stuff as immaturity. We move on. We don't think about really the outcomes of this or what's really stirring up in the hearts with this. So, well, this is awesome, Leslee. It's been so great to have you here, and I just again love what you're doing. I try never to miss an opportunity to hear you speak if I have that. And now we get to sit on CAPS together, the Canadian Association of Professional Speakers, which I'm thrilled at doing that as we both grow. And, people who are listening, like Leslee is it. She is real. She's authentic. I remember you saying that you were even a firefighter one time in the U.S., if I remember correctly, right? Yeah. And, she's like in the dirt, in the mud, in the fire, in the flames. And, but she's approachable, and we just appreciate you so much, Leslee. Thank you. Thank you for being here.
I concur.
I'm just grateful to. It's really neat to get the message out.
It is. Awesome. And we're glad you're the person to help us get that message out. That's been fantastic. So I concur with Tanya. It has been an absolute pleasure getting the opportunity to speak with you and getting to know you a little bit and asking you some questions about what it is that you do. So thanks for being here.
So
thanks, guys.
I want to ask you more questions. You're just going to have to find Leslee and talk to her and connect with her again. We'll have that contact information, but thank you everybody for the listeners, Leslee, for joining us. Please subscribe to our podcast and send us an email on who you would like to hear on the show. You can email us at safetydebris@gmail.com. Until the next time, I'm Tanya Steele.
And I'm Richard DeLong. And remember, don't let anyone ever tell you different. Safety does indeed have a personality. As we do with every episode, we like to close out the show with a Canadian artist. This is a fellow from Victoria. The song's called The Dove. This is Vince Vaccaro on Safety Debris.